Hey guys, it's Dora. I'm the education manager for Reef Relief. I'm out here on Summerlin Key exploring paddleboarding, and I wanted to find some marine invertebrates for you guys to learn more about. So join me today in this video and you're gonna learn all about the things that I saw out here. We're gonna do a little bit of a review of what you guys learned about me this past week, all about the different marine invertebrate phylums.
This is a loggerhead sponge in the phylum Periphera. So sponges, especially this one right here, are actually usually toxic to other vertebrates, except for the hawksbill sea turtle. This is a big part of their diet, and some other smaller fish will eat this kind of sponge here. Sponges are really, really important for the ocean. They filter the water and are responsible for keeping the water clear and clean of many different algal blooms that we can experience here. Not only are sponges important for our water quality, but they're also an important habitat. There are a lot of different invertebrates that will live within the pores and channels of the sponge for protection. And remember, your sponges are pore-bearing. They don't have any internal organs. They just have a lot of little holes and channels within their body to let the water and food flow through them.
Here we have a common sea star. So some people call it starfish, but it is definitely not a fish. It is an invertebrate, so again, it has no backbone. It belongs to the phylum Echinoderm. It's got radial symmetry, so you can draw a line in several directions and it would be the same if you folded it. So your echinoderms don't have blood like we do. They have blood that is just seawater. So if you see that circle on the top there, it's kind of hard to see. See that circle there? That actually helps push the seawater through their system. Now each arm holds their major organs. So they don't have their major organs in the center. If they lose an arm, they can regrow a new one. At the end of each arm also has an eye. Now the eye isn't very good for seeing. It's not seeing color. It's usually just seeing different changes in the lighting. Now on the underside of it, you see it's got little tube feet that are sticking to me right now. Those little tube feet right there is how they are able to move across the ground. Now in the center, you see its mouth. That's how they eat. What they do is they expel or take their stomach out of their mouth. Their stomach covers their food, mushes it all up, and they suck their stomach and that food right back in through their mouth. And that's how they eat. Most of your sea stars only have 5 arms, but some can actually have up to 24 arms, like the sunflower sea star. Here's what we call a sea cucumber. It's also in the phylum Echinoderm. So it does look a little odd. There are a lot of different kinds. It's very, very squishy. You see it also has the tube feet to help it maneuver around. Really cool fun fact about sea cucumbers is that a lot of them actually have a tiny fish that lives inside of them. So a tiny fish that lives inside some of these, it's called the pearlfish. Now that pearlfish uses that sea cucumber for protection. It's got a commensalism relationship, so one benefits, the other remains the same. That pearlfish gets protection, but the sea cucumber doesn't really get anything out of the relationship. So it's not effective. It's not hurt, but it's not helped. Alright, this is a horseshoe crab. It's named this because it's got that horseshoe-like head in the front there. It belongs in the phylum Arthropoda, so it's related to shrimp, crabs, and lobster. It's been on this planet for over 300 million years. And as I mentioned in that video, on Monday, they actually harvest horseshoe crabs and use their blood to help with detecting toxins on different medical equipment. They've got blue blood because they have copper in it instead. Now, unfortunately, even though they're really helpful for us in medicine and helpful in letting us know whether or not the medicine and the supplies are tainted, 30% of these guys do die after they are used for their blood. All right, guys, this is the underside of the horseshoe crab. As you can see, it can move its body for protection just like that. It's got 10 legs that it uses to move around. This is a calorie. It's in the phylum mollusca, so it's a mollusk. It is in the class gastropod, so it's related to conch and sea hares. Islanders used to actually use this shell as a form of currency, so they actually used to use this as money. You see that it looks kind of spiky. It's actually very soft. It's part of their mantle, and it's pulling it over its shell to protect itself from predators. You see there, that's the antennas that it's using to feel around. Here we have a spotted sea hare. So remember, the sea hare is named that because it kind of looks like a hare or a rabbit. As you can see here, it kind of looks like their ears. We call them horns. They have a really good sense of smell. They use these organs up here to help them smell. Now they have these two flaps right here to help them kind of fly through the water. You can see on the underside, they have a little bit of a sticky part there. Now the spotted sea hare is in the mollusk phylum, and they're in the class gastropoda. So they are a gastropod. So they're very similar to conch shells, other sea slugs, and nudibranchs. These guys do have the ability to ink. And also, guys, remember, they are the color of the algae and seagrass that they eat. So this one clearly eats more greenish yellow types of seagrass and seaweed. Here we have a upside down jellyfish, or a cassiopeia. Now this is a type of jellyfish. It is in the cnidarian phylum, along with corals and sea anemones. Now they do have those nematocyst stinging cells, however they're not very strong. So touching it really wouldn't be too bad of a sting. What they actually do is they release a mucus that have stinging cells. Kind of see that mucus right there. They release this mucus and they feel threatened, and the mucus actually has all the stinging toxins in it. And that's kind of how you get stung by them. There's a good reason why these guys are upside down, and that's because they have a symbiotic mutualistic relationship with an algae. Now again, that means that they both benefit. Mutualism means both benefits. They've got that algae in their tentacles there, and the algae goes through photosynthesis. Remember, that means that they get energy from the sun. So that algae goes through photosynthesis, and it gives the cassiopeia the energy it needs.
Here we have two different species of sea urchin. They are in the phylum Echinoderm, so they are related to sea stars. Now, some can be venomous. These two are not. So they are safe to hold. They actually move around by using their little tube feet and those spines that you see. A cool little fun fact about sea urchins is that their mouth and the teeth in their mouth are actually called Aristotle's lantern. This is called a brittle star. It's very closely related to sea stars. They're in the same phylum, Echinoderm. Now they're called brittle stars because their arms are very, very fragile and can break very easily. A lot of times, the brittle stars, when they feel threatened, they'll actually break their arms off to help them escape more easily from a predator. Unlike sea stars, brittle stars do not keep their important organs in their arms. Their important organs are located in that central disc that you see. Another big difference is that their arms are much more flexible, so they can crawl around a little bit better, they can poke into different things much easier. You often find brittle stars under rocks or in tiny, tiny holes, or even inside different sponges.
don't go away.
This is a crab. It's in the phylum Arthropoda. It's related to lobsters and horseshoe crabs as well. So these crabs are covered with a thick exoskeleton composed primarily of chitin. And they have a single pair of claws, as you can see here. They kind of scurry around like spiders do. Now, these crabs here usually are just scavengers, so they kind of crawl around on the seafloor looking for little scraps of food. So they'll eat any dead organisms that might have sunk to the bottom. They eat a lot of algae as well. These are hermit crabs in the phylum Arthropod, so they are just like crabs. They are born without shells, so once they're born, they actually have to go find their own shells. Typically, they will use shells of other snails or other gastropods to use as their protection because they have a very soft body. Hermit crabs cannot survive very long without a shell covering them and protecting them. Now, once they get bigger and bigger, they will have to move into larger shells. In fact, they will actually fight other hermit crabs for a more desirable shell. Some have pincers, some aren't very big, as you can see here. These ones aren't as big. I'm holding a sea snail. It's in the phylum Mollusk. It is a gastropod, so it's related to sea hares, conch shells, and nudibranchs, and sea slugs. That white circle that you see in between my fingers is the operculum. So at the end of these snails, these sea snails, they have a harder substance, and that's the operculum. When it feels threatened, it'll shrink into its shell, and all you can see is that. Now, if you remember in my fish dissection, we actually got to look at the fish's operculum. It's a hard panel that protects the gills. So just like the fish, our sea snails also have that operculum located at the end of their foot. Not only does it protect them, but it also helps them travel and move across the seafloor.